Monty, I want to explain something to you. See these shoes? I do not, whatever you do, do not hone in to these shoes. I couldn't find the ones that usually go with this, so you got to promise me you'll not hone in on these shoes. Raise your right hand and say this. I'm Ace McGirtis. I want to welcome you to Fire by Night. We've got a great show. We're going to be talking about bridging the generation gap, how we can communicate better with our parents and how our parents can communicate a little bit better with us, and some of the obstacles that come in the way of that kind of communication. We're going to be meeting with Phillips, Craig, and Dean. Now, even though these three guys have been in Christian music for years, they put out their first album, and it is hot. These boys can sing. So grab hold, hang on, and hook up, because we're going to have fun with a capital F.
Hey, bud, you want to go outside and play some ball?
Now, coaching now, Super Daddy Swagger!
Hey, son, you want to go play some ball?
Now, approaching the mound, Goofy Doo!
Some people about getting along with their mom and dads and brothers and sisters, and this is what they had to say. Do you get along good with your parents?
Yeah.
You do?
Yeah, but they're divorced.
They're getting divorced.
Are they married?
No.
Are they married?
No.
They're married.
They're married, man. That's great. Congratulations. Who do you get along better, your mom or your dad?
I live with my mom.
I live with my dad, and I didn't get along with my stepdad. I didn't like the idea of having someone else think they were my dad, I guess.
I get along with my mom good because I stay with my grandmother.
My mom's pretty mean, and my dad's pretty mean, too, so I don't get along with either one of them.
Do you love your daddy? That's good. Do you love your mommy, too? How do you get along with your mom and dad?
I get along with them really good.
So-so.
Great.
Oh, pretty good.
I don't want to answer that because both my parents watch it.
Can you talk to your mom and dad about anything?
Anything in the world.
Not really.
Not anything, but most stuff, yeah.
Yeah, my mom knows everything about me. My dad knows everything.
Really?
I don't feel any need to hide from them because if I do, I mean, I guess it's kind of lying to him, probably.
What are some things you really don't feel comfortable talking to him about?
Just a lot of things I do.
She knows everything. She isn't stupid.
We're talking to people about their relationship with their mom and dad. Are you parents?
You probably would not want to interview me then.
Are your parents married?
No.
When they get divorced, how old were you?
3 months.
What do you think somebody could do if they really wanted to work on their relationship to get along better with their parents?
Just appreciate the fact that they're there.
Thank you.
I got a new pick for you.
Cool.
I really always wanted to play guitar.
Really? I could teach you.
You could?
Yeah.
It looks so hard.
Just put your hand like this.
Turn up the radio.
Sing that one again.
How did you hook up? Because I know you're songwriters, and how did that come together?
I took a solo project to Star Song Records for their consideration, and they said they were mainly interested at that time in a vocal group.
Right.
So I knew them from a long time. Sean's done choir clinics for our church, and Dan's sung for us. So I knew them and discussed it with them, what something they'd like to do.
Uh-huh.
And they said, sure. Well, Sean was a little more hesitant, but...
Sean has to pray about
actually,
it.
They prayed about everything.
I'm a spiritual artist.
Actually, they went through about three or four people before they got to me.
We had to call some people out. We met in Dallas, and we... Really, the first time, we didn't even know what we sounded like. We put really a demo down for Star Song and sent it to them.
We learned three songs.
Yeah, we did. And they said, yeah, y'all come up and do a showcase for us. We were like, what?
We never had done a concert at
really?
This point, and so we had to... We arranged a concert at the church where I work at.
Uh-huh.
It was a Wednesday night, pouring down rain. We had about 100 people there, maybe 150.
We rocked the house.
It was.
Was it a transition going from being a songwriter to then putting together your own album and that capacity?
I think it was a transition, but it was real natural because a songwriter likes to sing his own stuff.
Yeah, and we had a. All three of us had done solo projects and had sang out. What really, if it was a transition, it was an easy transition.
Yeah, that's
we went
great.
From having, when you're a solo artist, you try to carry the whole program. Now we draw on each other and let Randy do most of the talking because he does anyway. You know, there's a lot of gloom in our world today. And as you'll be able to tell, we have a great time. We have a great time singing. We have a great time at our concerts. As well as ministry, kids need to know that this is a great life.
What do you see as one of the biggest needs in the church today, especially among teenagers?
They need to know that their trouble or their problems are not permanent, that they will change, that there is, like one of our songs says, there's a little bit of morning outside, that no matter how dark your night is, there's always a glimmer of hope that things are going to get better,
sure.
And they will change.
There's a lot of kids that are feeling a real sense of hopelessness, and you know, there's hope in Jesus Christ, and it's a great life.
What are some practical things that you do to stay on fire for the things of God?
There's a maintenance program that comes with our salvation. It's not a matter of whether we're saved or not, but it's a matter of staying on fire, like you said, and that comes from maintaining that gift that is in us through the Word, through our personal devotions, through the ministry of the local church, through prayer.
I learned this from my father. He used to be driving down the road, and I was a little kid. I thought he was crazy at the time. You know, he'd just start talking to the Lord with me in the car. But I learned that he lived in an attitude of prayer and thankfulness to God. And that's something I want to live in. It's just an attitude of being thankful to God.
Yeah.
All my devotion, oh yeah, take it from a man.
Monty, over here. Up here, by the tree, man. Yeah, there you go. Listen, I've got a key that's going to help you get along with your mom and dad to bridge that generation gap. It's found in the book of Ephesians chapter 6, verse 1. It says this, children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor thy father and mother, that it may be well with thee, and that thou mayest live long on the earth. I want you to see there's two keys that you can do to do your part to bridge that generation gap. First thing you got to do is you got to obey your mom and dad. And not only obey them, but it goes on to say, honor your father and mother. If you really want the promise, there has to be honor there. You know, lots of people are obedient. They'll obey their mom and dad. They tell them to take out the trash, tell them to mow the grass. But they do it with a chip on their shoulder. Like, I got to mow the grass. I don't want to do that. But you know, don't have that kind of attitude. Be obedient because you want to and not because you have to. Honor them. When they tell you to do something, put a smile on your face. Say, okay, I'll do it, then go ahead and do it. You make that attitude adjustment, and that's a key that's going to enable you to bridge that generation gap. What kind of stuff do you guys do together as a family?
We go out and eat sometimes. We go out in the backyard. We get a trampoline, go jump on the trampoline, watch movies.
We have cookouts a lot, I guess.
We go to church, eat dinner.
We attend church. After church and stuff, we go for drives.
We like to play golf and things like that.
We go see relatives.
Yeah, my mom goes to the movies and my dad just needs help.
My mom and I spend a lot of time together. I mean, go shopping and stuff.
Go to my baseball games. I go out to dinner with his family.
Yeah, he lives with us pretty much.
We have a dog. We walk our dog together. I have a horse and we got me ride our horse together.
And we just sometimes just drive around and look at all different houses and land and stuff because my dad just bought a bunch of land to put a horse on. And
Sometimes we just sit around, watch TV and rent a movie and eat popcorn together.
What could a teenager do you think that would help them get along better with their mom?
I'd try telling them more, letting them know a little more about themselves, you know. You tell your parents more, they're a little more understanding, a little more lenient.
Leave.
You just need to be honest and open with your parents.
Come out to Big Splash with their parents, I guess. That would be cool if my mom was out here. I think that'd be neat. She could spend all her money on me.
Be more honest, probably.
Try to be open with them.
Try to talk to them more often. Understand their problems so they can understand yours.
Try doing stuff around the house. Being good half the time. Trying to get along with my sister and brother.
Nothing.
Nothing.
Plant trees. Plant trees? I don't know what they could do. They
Thanks
can
very
plant
much.
Trees.
Spend more time with each other.
Communication is absolutely the best. A lot of my friends say, oh, I can't talk to my mom and I can't talk to my dad. But honestly, I think it's because the parents are afraid, you know, especially depending on, like, my parents, they grew up
in those hippie eras and all that stuff. And so I think they're more afraid of the mistakes they made they don't want their kids to make. And so if parents and kids could just have better communication between each other, and if parents understand and relate back to when they were our age and stuff, and just
listen to what their kids have to say, that'd be the best, I think.
How do you get along with your parents?
Fine.
You have any brothers or sisters?
Yeah, him.
Yeah, how do you get along with him?
Good.
Can you talk to your parents about anything?
Yeah, sometimes.
What do you like to do with your mom and dad the best?
Sports.
Do you play anything?
Soccer.
Well, where do you look right after you make a goal, usually?
To the stands.
To mom and dad. Getting along with your mom and dad and brothers and sisters, that takes work. You have to make an effort at communicating. And you know, it's a decision that you can make. You will bridge that generation gap. You know, life may not always seem fair.
Now, son, you're gonna have to be strong and help your mama since your dad's left. You're the man of the house now.
Sometimes life may not always seem fun.
Your Uncle Larry got you this job. It's really gonna help our family. You've always made me so proud.
It may not seem like your dreams are ever coming to pass.
Honey, I know we set that money aside for you to go to college, but since your brother got sick, you're gonna have to use it.
But don't ever give up, because your payday will come.
It's a 5-liter, has a crank and stereo, power windows, and even air conditioning.
Oh, man, your dad bought this for you?
Yeah, man.
Man, I am so ready for a car. I saw this great convertible on the way home from the lake Saturday, sitting in this guy's driveway with a for sale sign on it.
Well, have you talked to your dad about it?
No.
Go for it, man.
Yeah, the worst he could say is no.
Well, I guess I could do that. Hey, Tommy, what's up?
Oh, just experiencing my token midlife crisis.
So soon?
Yeah, I'm being stalked by Polyester Man.
Who?
My dad. It's his vacation, and he's got this bright idea to invest in my education. He's gonna volunteer his help in science class.
They still let parents do that?
He's a nuclear physicist.
So, what is the American dream? It's liberty for all. It's freedom from oppression. And it's the opportunity to succeed.
Hey, Carrie.
Hi, Miss Cambridge.
I just came to grab some articles to proof. What you working on?
My speech.
So today's the big speech. How you feeling? A little nervous?
No, I feel really good. I'm prepared for this.
I know you'll do great. Keep me posted.
Okay, I will. So, what is the American dream?
Here we have your atom. We have your proton and neutron living in their own happy little world. Hello, how are you doing today? Oh, pretty good considering that I had a flat tire and I had to go to Walmart to get it fixed. Oh, that's too bad. I hope your day gets better. But, unexpectedly, out of the blue, Mr. Electron decides to pay a visit. Mr. Electron! Notice the women and children showing signs of despair. The men are desperately trying to hold it together. Hold on! Shut up! Move together! But it's too late. Mr. Electron has hit warp speed, and the brakes have gone out, and it's collision time! And that is what we call a nuclear explosion.
So, what is the American dream? It's liberty for all. It's freedom from oppression. And it's the opportunity to succeed. It's the heritage passed down from our great forefathers that we, the people, might experience happiness and hope.
Good day. Enjoy the rest of your classes. Watch those, yeah. And here we have Mr. Proton.
Thank you.
You know, Mr. Kramer, I do want to tell you thank you very much, because I think your visit here today has been very enlightening.
Well, do you think the students got anything out of it?
Oh, yes. I think you've made a very, very good impact on the class here.
Well, you know, there's nothing quite like educating the minds of today's youth.
Mr. Kramer, I feel like I must tell you that you are really very good at it. As a matter of fact, I'll bet your boy Tommy there is very proud to have a dad like you.
Oh, now come on.
No, I mean it. As a matter of fact, any time you would like to come back and teach this class, I would be honored to have you.
Oh, thanks for the offer, Mr. Norris, but Dad's real.
Why, sure I do.
But Dad, but...
I just started a 2-week vacation. There's nothing more I'd rather do than to come back.
Then that settles it. Can you come back tomorrow?
Sure. I've just made a homemade cannon with fruit juice cans.
Oh, wonderful, wonderful. Can I show you something, Mr. Kramer?
Yes, you may.
This is kind of a little...
Miss Johnson?
Yes, Carrie?
I've got some questions about the evaluation you gave me.
Let me see. Seems pretty specific. What was your question?
Well, I worked a long time on this speech, and I felt good about it. it was a good speech. And I think it deserves a better grade.
Carrie, it had some nice moments. But it didn't fit the format that I laid out for the class. I gave you some very specific guidelines to go by in preparing this assignment.
I know, but I think we should be allowed a little artistic liberty with this topic. I mean, every subject is different. You can't just make it fit a mold.
Carrie, how much liberty you take is up to you. But I have to grade you according to the standards that I said I would. It's my responsibility to the class. Now, if you're interested in pulling up this grade, you can re-deliver your speech on Friday at the meet. But it's going to take some work first.
All right, thanks.
Well, you did it again, honey. Great dinner.
So, Dad, about this car.
Eric, don't talk with your mouth full.
Sorry, Mom. I checked the tires, and they've got plenty of tread left on them. The mileage was a little high, about 72,000, but they're all highway miles.
Yeah, and I bet a little old lady owned it, too.
You know, I think you're right. The guy's mom did own the car.
Okay, well, we'll have to look at it sometime.
Why not now? I've got all my homework done, and it doesn't get dark for 2 more hours.
Yeah, Dad, can we go and get some ice cream?
Who invited you?
He invited himself. That's his way.
Seriously, why don't you all make this a men's night out, and I'll keep Angie here with me.
Yeah, and I'll help Mom with the dishes.
As soon as they leave, we'll go to the mall.
Now, she's got kind of a touchy accelerator guy, so take it easy, all right? And be careful.
Yes, sir, Mr. Simpson.
I'll keep an eye on him. Got great pickup.
Yeah, good brakes, too.
We'll call you tomorrow.
Kramer's here.
Ooh, Kramer the man.
Atomic man. Hey.
Yeah,
man. Way to go, Kramer.
Yeah. Kramer, yeah.
Particular topic, you might want to change the tense to first person. Remember, anytime you use third person, you automatically distance your readers.
Man, I'm telling you, I've never seen a car like this. We're talking power, smooth. We're going down the road, the top was down, the breeze blowing through our hair. It was like one of those commercials.
Well, what'd your dad say?
Well, he said you think about it.
Cool.
Miss Cambridge, could you come here for a second?
Sure.
Having trouble getting out this file.
That's not like her. I've never known Miss Johnson to be unfair.
I know. I always thought she liked me. But did you hear Bobby Bradley's speech?
Yeah, that was pretty bad. I felt so sorry for him. He must have been so nervous.
He got a B. Mine was much better than his.
I thought so. Didn't she give you any reasons?
Oh, she rambled off something about format. And then said I could make it up Friday at the meet. She's just so unreasonable sometimes.
So we see that it's not enough just to have an explosion. But in order to be effective, it must be directed. Take yourself, for example. When your sister comes into your room and starts touching all your things, what do? You go for the neck! A direct explosion to the neck. And girls, when that slug you call a brother comes into your room and starts clipping his toenails right when you're on the phone talking to, Roger, generally direct a book or a shoe in his direction, right? So we see that the best explosion is a controlled explosion. So let's see how we can harness explosive power so that we can make it work for us. Now, I've brought a homemade cannon, a Nerf ball, and, well, it seems like I've left my magic potion in the wagon. Tommy, would you stand up, son? This is my son, Tommy. Isn't he a fine young man? Tommy, come here, please. Would you go out in the car and get my methyl alcohol? I think it must have rolled out of the bag or something. Thank you. Now, how many of you like to shoot bottle rockets?
Nice car, Eric.
Susie.
Eric, what?
Aye, mates. And if you're gonna sail the seven seas, you got to have a cannon. And what good is a cannon unless you got a cannonball? And after we stuff her in here, we'll put the magic potion in, and then we'll heat her up. Here. All right. Now hold your ears and stand back. There she blows! Oh. I guess I need to check. Mates, the magic potion's probably not working correctly. Yes. That didn't. Oh, that's funny.
So the plane's going down, right? But there's only one parachute between the two donkeys.
I've already heard it.
So you want to hit Donnie's for a Coke? I'm buying.
You're buying? I'm in. Eric, you coming?
No. I'll see you guys later. What time did you say Dad was getting home?
He'll be here, Eric. Just be patient. Here, what do you think of this?
Well, you ready to go pick up my car?
Well, good afternoon to you, too. Hi, honey.
Hi. Well?
I think you better sit down.
Okay.
Son, I have really prayed about this. Seems like a great car. But I just don't feel good about it right now.
Why?
Eric, I don't know why. Something's just not right.
It's the perfect car. I don't understand.
You don't have to understand. If you're trusting God for a car, you've got to trust Him. And you've got to trust us.
Eric, God has the perfect car for you. And at the perfect time. We'll just keep looking.
What if you're missing God?
Hey, Tommy. Where's your dad?
Oh, he's not coming.
What?
Not coming.
He was the best teacher.
Man, he helped me fix my flat.
He taught me to balance my checkbook.
Yeah!
Yeah. 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 Yeah.
Mr. Tyler,
what do you do if you think your parents are wrong?
Well, that depends on what it is. I mean, if they're asking you to rob a 7-Eleven or, you know, beat up Mr. Brown, that's one thing. But, hey, if it's just a judgment call and it's not against the Word of God, you need to listen to them. It's about that car, isn't it?
Yeah. I really want that car. I don't think my dad has any reason to say no.
Eric, let me ask you. Are you trusting God for that car?
Yeah.
Well, then you need to realize He's working all things out for your good. Maybe the timing's not right. Maybe He has a better car for you. But understand this, we don't always see the big picture.
But what if they're missing God?
God will make it up to you. You see, if you honor God, God's going to honor you.
You know, Mr. Tyler, you're right.
No, you don't have to check it. You just turn it on and leave.
You mean it just turns off when the rice is done?
Yes.
And you don't have to check it?
No, it's a very smart machine. It knows when it's done.
Well, how does it know?
It knows. It has a little sensor thing.
When did they get one of those?
Hi, girls.
Hi, Miss Johnson.
Angie, about ready for that big debate this weekend?
Yeah, I think so.
Good. If I can do anything to help, let me know.
Okay, I will. Thanks, Miss Johnson. Bye.
Bye, Angie.
Drag. Parents said no?
Yeah, but you know, it's okay. God's gonna work it out. I've just chosen to honor my parents on this. They don't want me to get a piece of junk. They're gonna get me something nice.
I don't know. Did you see what Billy's dad bought for him?
Ricky, I trust my parents. No, I do. Like, even if I didn't trust them, I trust God. Look, I'm gonna get a Jag or something, and you're just gonna be begging to be seen with me.
Yeah, right.
Carrie, do you have a few minutes?
I guess so.
Come on, let me buy you a coat. Remember the first time you gave a speech in my class? You talked about that little homeless boy. You created his life in the minds of the audience. You described his walk to school and the holes in his shoes and his loneliness being passed from orphanage to orphanage. Within 10 minutes, the entire class was rallying to find him a home. All the guys were crying. Carrie, the ability to stir people and motivate them to action is a wonderful gift. You shouldn't take it lightly.
I don't, Miss Johnson. Really, I love speech. And there's so much I want to do with it.
I know.
I feel like I'm suffocating. I want to have the freedom to create myself.
And it's difficult to work within a preset format.
It is.
Carrie, that frustration will probably get worse before it gets better. Expect it. But don't give in to it. Unless you learn to discipline your gift now and refine it, you'll never reach your full potential. I want that for you.
Is that why you've been so hard on me?
Uh-huh. The exercises we do in class are each designed to teach a particular skill. It's important that you learn them one at a time, that you master them and make them yours. Then, when you're given your freedom, your gift will work for you. It'll be strong and consistent.
And in the meantime,
experiment at home. Just don't do it during class.
Hey, Dad.
Hi, Tommy. How was school?
Bad day.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. We had this teacher at the beginning of the week. I guess I kind of thought he was goofy. But he turned out to be a pretty nice guy. Sure wish he'd come back. Besides, now Mr. Norris is playing this really hard quiz on Friday.
Oh, you mean it?
Yeah, I haven't studied a bit.
Tommy!
No, really, I am sorry. I am.
with the car. I thought you said no.
I did. This isn't the same car.
It's not?
No, this one doesn't have as many miles on it.
Really?
And it's safer.
Want to take it for a spin?
You bet.
So what is the American dream? It's the soybean ranch that feeds Jesse Harding's family. And it's Jose Ramirez's shoe store. It's a home for little Billy Richardson. And a new heart for Rachel Sullivan. It's people working together, helping each other to build meaningful lives. The American dream is, in reality, your dream and my dream. Our dream gives us the right to fight oppression and bigotry. Our dream is our hope. And our hope is the spirit that makes us America.
Welcome to Perilous Times. I'm your host. The breakdown of the American family has been a topic given much attention over the past several years. Psychologists, sociologists, anthropologists, even cosmetologists have spent months, even days, trying to pinpoint the causes and solutions to this national disaster. We here at Perilous Times decided to ask you, the viewer, for your thoughts on the subject. We caught up with our first guest at a nearby park.
Excuse me. What's your name?
Joey Stevens.
Excuse me, Joey. I'm glad to meet you. Can I ask you some questions about your family?
Look, man, I just escaped from a state boarding school. I haven't got any family.
Talking about the breakdown in the American family, any solutions? Can I ask you just a couple of questions? Hi.
Hey, aren't you, Perilous Times?
Yeah.
Yeah, my kids watch you all the time.
So you got a family?
Well, yeah, I got a couple of kids.
Divorced?
Eh, never was married. Just a piece of paper.
If you let him, a man will take everything you've got. Your house, your car, your checkbook. I can't stand men.
I just can't stay with one person. After a while, I get bored.
My old man said if I ever step foot in his house again, he's calling a lock.
Is there anything you could do to smooth things over?
Probably if I stop doing crack.
Sure it'll work. I stop for somebody dressed like this every day.
Yeah, but this is not a school cross.
Doesn't matter. As long as I have this stop sign, it's a thing of respect. It's like saluting the flag. Now, come on.
All right,
come on. Ah, get up!
If they want me to come back, they can forget it.
Why did you leave?
Because I ain't got time to be jerked around doing my homework and cleaning my room. Me and my boyfriend are blowing this town.
Is he supposed to meet you here?
Yeah, yesterday.
Hi, Perilous Times out here to... Maybe we better come back a little later. Hey, I think we got somebody. Oh, it's just my wife.
What are you doing?
I'm just trying to get some interviews.
Well, I'm glad I saw you. Could you take these things to the cleaners? Uh-huh. And while you're out, I'm going to take Greg to the daycare, and I need you to pick up some diapers for Jeffrey. He's out.
Okay.
And here's a few more things that we could use. Oh. And where is your cat? You're getting way too much sun.
Oh,
well, here's Greg's. Look. And okay. If you want some good interviews, you may try Billy's park, okay? Gotta go, hon. See ya. Bye.
Turn that off. Nobody here but a bunch of kids. I mean, what's a kid gonna say?
Hey, you may as well ask him. I mean, we're here now, aren't we?
Hey, buddy. Can I ask you a couple of questions?
Shoot.
Hey, we're talking about the breakdown of the American family. Is there anything that you could think of that might be a solution to this national disaster?
Okay. Three things. Number one, husbands must love their wives as Christ loves the body. Number two, wives must respect and love their husbands. And number three, children must obey their parents in the Lord. Anything else I can help you with?
Gotta admit, the kid had something to say. It's obvious that some folks don't have a clue when it comes to fielding a family fiasco or staying stable during stormy times. But we here at PT want to go on record as saying we believe that the family is a terrible thing to waste. Until next time, I'm your host, and this is Perilous Times.
We've been talking about bridging the generation gap. You know something that's real important, and that is that God wants you to have a good relationship with your mom and dad, your brothers and sisters, and your friends. In fact, there's a scripture in the Bible in 1 John chapter 1, verse 7. It says, if you walk in the light, as He is in the light, you will have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, His Son, cleanses you from all sin. Now, a good barometer to telling how your relationship's going with God is, how's your relationship going with other people? Are you getting along with your mom and dad, your brothers and sisters and friends? Because I tell you, if you're not, I can guarantee this, you're not having a good relationship with the Lord. It's guaranteed. If you walk in the light as He's in the light, guaranteed you will have fellowship with one another. Now, a pastor one time told me something, and I've never forgot it. He told me there's two keys to living in victory, two keys to walking in the light as He is in the light. Key number one, you have to be quick to repent. And key number two, you have to be quick to forgive. Key number one, when you're quick to repent, if you sin, you blow it, you mess up, lose your cool, get mad at somebody, say things you shouldn't say, fall into sin, you have to be quick to repent. A lot of people, they wait until the evangelist gives an altar call before they repent. Don't do that. Be quick to repent right when the Holy Ghost begins to convict you of sin. Don't wait until a church service. Don't wait till you go to summer camp. Be quick to repent. Ask God to forgive you. Get washed in the blood of Jesus, because that blood cleanses you from all sin. I like what the Bible says in the book of Proverbs. It tells us the just man may fall down seven times, but he gets back up again. If you fall into sin, don't stay down there wallowing in that guilt and condemnation. Be quick. Get back up again. Ask God to forgive you. Get washed in the blood and go on with what God has for you. Key number two, be quick to forgive. You know, when Jesus was teaching us the Lord's Prayer, He said, Father, forgive me my trespasses, and I'll forgive those that trespass against me. Key number one, we found that is quick to repent. But key number two is we also have to forgive other people that have sinned against us, that have hurt us, that have offended us. Don't hold on to hurt feelings. It's important that you're quick to let those things go. You know, I remember when I was just a boy of 11 years old, my mom and dad decided to get a divorce. And that devastated me. And you know what I did? I focused all that hurt, all that bitterness, and all that pain in on my mother. And I began to blame her for the divorce. And when I got saved some 5 years later, I didn't deal with it. I kept that hurt in my heart. And I remember one day I'm driving down the road and just, you know, talking to my wife. And all of a sudden, my wife, Angel, she looks up at me and she says, you know something, Eastman? You need to forgive your mom. You need to quit harboring that bitterness. And I really didn't know that I was doing that. I said, what do you mean? And my wife told me, she said, Eastman, ever since I've known you, you've had bitterness in your heart toward your mother. And I didn't really know that I did, but I never dealt with it. And when she said that, that was like taking a 2x4 and hitting me right across the head. I realized that I had harbored bitterness and hurt in my life toward my mother. Well, I knew I never got along real good with my mom, but that was the key. I had never forgiven her. Well, this is what I did. I began to cry and I realized, hey, I need to ask Mom to forgive me for holding that bitterness in. So I called her up on the phone. I said, Mom, don't leave. I need to talk to you. I rushed to my mother's house. I went busting in the door. I gave my mom a big hug. I'm crying. I'm weeping. I said, Mom, would you please forgive me? Because I've blamed the divorce. I've blamed everything on you. And I ask you to forgive me. I want God to give me a mom back. And you know what God did? Supernaturally, God gave me a mother back. You know what else God did? God gave a mother a son back. And some of you are here, and you may have held bitterness in your heart toward your mom, toward your dad, toward your brothers or sisters. I want to encourage you, don't hold that bitterness in. Let that go. Let me pray with you right now. Heavenly Father, I'm asking you to touch every man, every young woman watching this video. And Lord, if they may have friction in their family, I'm asking you right now to allow them enable them to make a decision right now to forgive their mom and to forgive their dad. In Jesus' name, amen. If you'll go to your mom, go to your dad and hug them and ask them to forgive you for holding in that bitterness, if that's you, you know something? God will give you a mom back. He'll give you a dad back. He'll restore and bridge that generation gap. Thanks for joining us on Fire by Night. And remember, you do your part on bridging the generation gap because you can make a difference. Now, next show, we'll be talking about taming the toxic tongue. You won't want to... Hey! Like I said, we'll be talking about taming the toxic tongue. Somebody's going to pay for that. Help me up. Come on, help me. Hey! Wait a minute!
Yeah.